the music to finish before I come on screen, because it'll cut it off if I don't. So that's how that goes. Hey, Michael Grayson.
How are we doing today?
Doing good, man. How are you?
Good, man. Thanks for having me back on the show. I love being here.
Absolutely. I love what's going on in the background of your screen there. I like whatever that is on the... What is that? What is that burst of color I see?
I am not quite sure, but I did find it in my wallpaper folder on my Macintosh.
That's awesome.
Yeah, I'm sure it's on yours.
I'm going to find it because I really like the way that looks. Let me just turn down, let me unmonitor myself. I can't stand it when I can hear myself, because then the latency gets all out of control. I know those terms now because I've been researching it. Anyway, well, hey, everybody. This is episode, I think it was 132. I don't know what episode it is, but I think it's 132 of the HooperCast. So Dustin is working for a living. So Michael is joining us tonight for the show, and we're going to talk about the founder tonight. So if you're watching this, you're obviously on the YouTube page. So good for you for listening last episode when I explained where we would be. Still trying to find some alternatives for sound mixing. So if anybody listening has a way for me to get Skype audio routed through something without making me do any post-production, I'd love to hear it. I got Michael on it. I got my best men on it, and I need the rest of you second best men on it. Yeah, everyone help me, please. Please help me. Please help me.
please help me.
Michael, what have you been up to since the last episode? It hadn't been too long. We talked, you were on a few episodes ago, weren't you?
Yeah, I was. We had a nice time, but that episode we talked about maybe 10 or 15 different films. Yeah.
Yeah.
No, I'm good. Things are good. Been working. I actually have I'm real involved in there's a high school in Dallas I'm really involved with. I substitute there, and I help after school classes as far as filmmaking and post-production techniques. And this weekend is the big film festival. So 56 student high school films. Very excited to have helped with each and every one of them. And they are having their debut on Sunday. And two of the students from this particular high school are going to be attending Savannah College of Art and Design starting this fall. So it's been absolutely great. It's been a very rewarding experience. That's kind of where I've been.
Yeah, dude. So, awesome. Yeah. You mentoring the young folk.
That's right, man. I have a good time up there. And they, you know, it's an incredible film department that they do. And of course they bring me in to work on post-production sound techniques and production sound techniques. So I'm going to be giving master classes this Saturday, and the film festival is this Sunday, and they actually rented out an independent movie theater. And apparently they've already sold out. So,
ooh,
very exciting stuff.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
That's good to hear, man. It's always good to hear that, it's not a hard industry to get people excited in. I always sort of thought, like, you know, it's among the least boring, career paths that are out there, but it's still interesting to see people getting involved in film for the right reasons. You know, this is kind of the industry where you want to turn artists loose. You know, you don't want to turn casual practitioners of tax law loose on being a CPA. You want the best of the best, and you want curious artists taking part in this art form. So it's really cool to
No, absolutely. And you know, it's not that, you know, they spend all year long working on how to light and make a really pretty shot. They're not working for years on how to hold a boom pole. They're not what the whole mission of the program is, how to tell a good story well. Yeah. It's storytelling. It's not the particulars of dolly shots or static shots or color correction or what. It's storytelling. And that is the main message of what we're doing. And when it comes to storytelling, I think the founder told a damn good story.
Look at you with your segues and everything, you fancy. Fancy man. Well, let's all right, fine, let's get started on the founder. Well, let me roll some video, because that's what I do now.
That's awesome. Came out January, yeah. John Carroll Lynch. Yeah. Oh, he's great. Yeah, Mac McDonald and Dick McDonald, they're brothers. Yeah. And I don't know about how accurate the story was. You know how Hollywood is. I don't know, because I don't know the story of McDonald's from what I haven't done my own research on the story of McDonald's. I haven't. But from the story that was told in The Founder, it was wild. And it was about Michael Keaton wanting to promote this business, wanting to franchise this business, and all the loopholes he had to go through in order to make this a successful franchise. And what I thought was really great is, total spoiler alert for the record, but he started this, and he was part of the country club, and he went to the country club, and he pitched it to his rich friends, and his rich friends bought a franchise, opened it up. They didn't become successful franchises because he sold them to people who didn't want to work. So later in the movie, you see he finds a different kind of client, and he starts selling the franchises to hardworking individuals. And he really goes for the family, the husband and wife teams who want to work together, and they're not afraid to get down and get dirty and work hard to make it work. This is a dialogue-heavy film. This is storytelling. This is not Fast and the Furious, where you see explosions and cars and chicks on the beach in bikinis. I mean, this is a very dialogue-heavy film, and it was great. And I think John Lee Hancock, who directed it, was fantastic. Yeah, I don't know if you saw Saving Mr. Banks. See, that's another really dialogue-heavy film. And BJ Novak was actually in that one as well. So BJ Novak did a great job in The Founder with John Lee Hancock, as well as Saving Mr. Banks. I mean, the cast itself was great. And I love Michael Keaton, don't get me wrong, man. I look at Michael Keaton as being Tim Burton's first little protege before Johnny Depp. You know what I mean? And then when he did Birdman, and I don't recall if Birdman won Best Picture or if he won Best Actor. I don't recall. But I, man, I just I've I love Michael Keaton, man. I just think he's fantastic. He was nominated. That's what it was. He was nominated for Best Performance. That's right. And he was, yeah. I pulled it up on IMDb. Yeah, he was nominated for Birdman. Learning. Yes. Oh, he's a total asshole. And aggressive. Yeah.
Persistent, like he says.
Yeah.
He saw something he wanted and he took the steps he took it. He risked everything. And he made himself indispensable, and he made himself set himself up to succeed or fail, like, you know, soup to nuts. Like what's not good about him is he commoditizes something that's genuine. So he finds these two genuine brothers, and basically figures out a way to exploit what is real about them and use that name. And and start to kind of cut corners and make it grow. And you can't really blame him for taking those steps, but you can't really blame the brothers either. You know, their whole thing is they're the genuine article. They're the real deal. And you can't blame them for going like, hey dude, you're kind of like cramping our style. Like you're making fake milkshakes, you're growing too fast. Like, well, we're not bringing you in. We don't need this rapid expansion. And then being like, what's the matter with you guys? You want to make money? And they're like, no, we love making money.
Right. Not anymore. Yeah. No, absolutely. And when you say you watched that movie and Michael Keaton wasn't portrayed as the hero, but he wasn't portrayed as the villain, but by no means was he a nice guy. You got to look at the McDonald brothers. You know, the McDonald's brothers, because they weren't the nice guys either. You know, the two there was so much conflict resolution from both parties. The fact that Michael Keaton wanted to grow this into a business rapidly, he didn't have the permission to do so with all the legislation he'd have to go through the brothers. And when he realized that, he decided, you know what? I don't care. And then he meets BJ Novak, and it's a great line. He says, Ray, you're not in the food service industry business. You're in the real estate business. And it was genius. It was absolutely genius. But what an incredible story, really, just from the brothers fighting with Ray and giving Ray an inch at a time and so on and so forth. It was just fantastic. And I'm glad he divorced his wife because his wife was pretty awful. I couldn't stand her. Yeah. I didn't either. Yeah. 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 No. Yeah, they're sitting at the dinner table at the club, and she goes, "This one's different." Yeah. 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 He's not a very faithful man. Oh.
My audio way down. Whoopsie daisy. That's going to sound really low. Well, I did it on the box on the, I don't know what I did. I hope I haven't been low this whole time. Oh well. anyway.
So let's start from the beginning. The Founder was a great film.
Mm-hmm.
No.
yeah. What do you think? I guess I'm saying, like, what do you think stopped them? Because it got passed over for nominations this year, but was that because it didn't make the window? Or do you think it was because it was just not marketed very broadly?
You know, I don't have an answer for that. I don't. I have no idea why it, but you know how the Academy is. They're so political. So I don't know what happened. I don't know if it didn't make the cut, if it didn't get rotation for screeners. Yeah. I'm not sure what happened, but it was a great film. It was a filmmaker's film. It was fantastic.
Yeah, I like I said, I'm enjoying it a lot more in the last few minutes just now than I think I did leading up to doing this, the show tonight. Yeah. Okay, cool. Well, that's The Founder, everybody. You can
check it out.
I got it at Redbox. I don't know where you saw it, Michael.
Yeah. Redbox.
Yeah, dude.
Yeah.
So here's the fun part of having you on the show. There's not really an agenda right now. We're 19 minutes into the show. we're done talking about the thing that I prepared for. I have no clips loaded yet. Have you seen anything else of note lately since we last spoke?
Yes, I have. I saw a movie called War Dogs.
War Dogs.
With Jonah Hill and Miles Teller.
Okay.
Oh my gosh, have you not heard about this picture?
I have not heard. I may have heard this. I'm finding it right now. This is the kind of stuff that I get flagged for later on by Warner Brothers, but
Jonah Hill got fat again for this film and it was amazing.
What a brave soul.
Yeah, I know, right? I don't think he had any trouble doing that. But he's like, essentially, all right. Essentially the idea is that Jonah Hill and Miles Teller, and this is based on a true story, is that these two kids decide they want to make a quick buck by bidding on government contracts for weapons, ammunition.
Check it out.
Military vehicles, all sorts of stuff. And they end up winning a $300 million contract.
Mm-hmm.
And they fulfill the contract, but part of the contract was 100 million rounds of AK-47 ammunition.
Oh.
And as we all know, America had an embargo, a trade embargo with China. Turns out the ammunition was Chinese, and the second half of the film is about how they try to pass off Chinese ammunition for Albanian ammunition, and they get caught. And then you see the whole legal aspect of it, the trouble they get into.
Mm-hmm.
But, brother, I'm telling you, Connor, if you have not seen War Dogs, I watched it on HBO, and it was a great, great watch.
Well, hell, dude, I usually watch stuff you recommend to me, like, just right off the bat. Like, I don't even ask questions. I just take your word for it. So when you tell me that this is a good movie, that's why I watched The Founder. I wasn't going to watch it. I wasn't unneutral enough about it, I guess. Yeah. You know.
Well, you know who Miles Teller is. He's that kid from Whiplash.
Yeah, I know. And Miles Teller was at the film festival one year. Remember that?
Oh yeah, he was. He was at the Scott Festival. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, he was.
Man, he's a great actor. He sucked in the Allegiant and Divergent series, but other than that, I mean, he's awesome.
I thought he was one of the better parts of those.
I thought all those movies were garbage.
He got slapped in the face really, really well.
Yeah. I didn't like any of those movies.
Yeah, including the one that's a TV movie now, right? Didn't the last one, they were like, yeah, there's not enough interest.
They pulled the production budget or something.
They basically were like, we're not going to release this in theaters. Like they basically said, this is the best we can do to break even is not pay theaters to release this. And they just, it's like, it, I can't remember what channel it was. I should find that out.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was.
That's awesome.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I mean, dude, I usually, oh shit, I gotta keep playing my stuff. God, it's bad, Connor. Man, he did get pretty fat for this.
You see anything? I mean, I tried to put on Rings, the Ring sequel, and I turned it off after the intro sequence.
Oh, Rings?
Rings, the horror film.
No, I let me see. I saw so lately I've been doing a thing, and I this is the part of me that tries to like make this a show and like give things names. And so I'll do stuff like, hey, I'm going to watch, like, I got too many movies, right? So, and I don't watch a lot of them. So for me, it's like, I'm going to go through the movies that are on my shelf, and I'm either going to get rid of them or I'm going to like keep them.
Yeah.
Because I got stuff like, I've got the Indiana Jones trilogy, on Blu-ray, and I haven't even opened them.
Really?
Because I've seen the film, so I know I like them, but I haven't viewed this Blu-ray set. I bought this like 4 or 5 years ago, and I put it on the other day as like the background for a party, and I kept looking over at it, and I was like, I'm gonna watch this sometime. This is pretty cool, you know. And yeah, so I decided like I need to clear some space on the shelf, and so I watched Changeling. Recently, do you remember Changeling? You've heard of, you know, you remember Changeling? So Changeling is a movie by Clint Eastwood, and it came out, I think, 2008 or 2009 maybe. And it stars, let me see if I can get some video for you. It stars Angelina Jolie. Oh, that guy probably has a watermark on it. Forget that guy. Let's find Warner Brothers. Is there a Warner Brothers one? So yeah, Changeling. Yeah, 2008. So Changeling.
Oh, I just read about it.
The problem is that these people, they have these watermarks. I want the Warner Brothers one. So if anyone's going to flag me, it's big old Warner Brothers and not some other dude. Man. Okay. Well, Changeling stars Angelina Jolie. And it takes place in like the late 20s during the Great Depression.
Okay.
I don't even think it's Warner Brothers. I don't know who it is. I'm just taking this, guys. Forget it. Get your stupid logo out of the way, you son of a bitch. Okay. Oh, see, he's just taking, I'm wasting time. Yeah, Changeling stars Angelina Jolie, directed by Clint Eastwood, and it's about a mother who in the, you know, 1920s Los Angeles, and her son goes missing. You know, back then you'd leave the kids at home all day.
Yeah.
I'll be back for supper, you know. And she misplaces her son. And so they, you know, she's freaked out, and everything, you know, everything you can imagine, like losing your kid, like you're looking for, you know, even back then, like, okay, so he's not had the neighbors. Have you seen Walter? Have you seen him? No, Mrs. Collins. No, we haven't seen him. And that's kind of freaky. So she calls the cops, does, you know, everything you're supposed to do. Where did this thingy go? I don't know. Oh, there it is. Okay. Let's get this show on the road so I can get off screen. There we go. All right. So, the big thing about this, so the LAPD, so they come back 5 months later and they're like, we found him, Mrs. Collins. And they bring her to the train station. They got the press there and all that. And, that's not her kid. She's like, that's not my son. And they're like, yeah, it is. She's like, what? No, he's not. And they're like, yeah, he is. He is your son. And it's basically about how the LAPD at this time, especially, there was a lot of scandals, and the public eye was really focused in on them. And so for them, it was a big embarrassment that they had found the wrong kid.
Oh my God.
And they're like, well, this kid says he's Walter Collins. And, you know, and they kept trying to tell her, like, you know, maybe you're confused, Mrs. Collins. And, you know, or maybe you liked being free and you enjoyed, you know, life without your kid. And she's like, how dare you? They have her committed to a psych ward. You know, they accuse her multiple times of being crazy, of lying. They have her committed. Yeah. She goes to, like, she gets institutionalized, you know, and they're trying to make her disappear because it's an embarrassment for them. They hose her down, all that junk. It's a little bit of a flashback to Girl Interrupted for Angelina Jolie. And John Malkovich is there too. And he's like this reverend who's been crusading against the police for a long time for trying to expose them. And it's a long, long film. But it's a really good film. Clint Eastwood's always really good at.
I love him. Yeah.
Yeah. Atmosphere is his big strength. He's very good at setting. That's like, I think that's his big strength. He always gets, you know, actors, and his actors are hit and miss. You know, if you ever seen Gran Torino, those kids are horrible, horrible, awful acting in that film. Some of the worst I've seen. You know, Angelina Jolie is very good. I would say this is a career best for her.
Really? Okay.
Because at this point, like, she hadn't done that many serious movies. Like, she's still kind of like, you know, sexy Angelina Jolie, Mr. and Mrs. Yeah. Smith, you know. And so she comes out and, you know, I was Clint Eastwood, and she's this mother, and she, you know. The only thing about this is a small nitpick, but she is very skinny, and that's a little distracting sometimes. But actually, in this sense, it works for the character because these women are just... You know, they're working and everything in the 20s, but they're getting kind of pushed around. A lot of these dudes are telling her, like, you're just being crazy. And she's like, no, that's not my kid, you son of a bitch. Like, no. You know, you can't. And it's a really, you know, it doesn't have a happy ending, but she goes through a journey. Her character has an arc. You know, you see her going from a very agreeable person to somebody who is, something's been taken from her. It's weird because usually in movies it's like something's been taken from this person and, you know, they're trying to get it back. So she's trying to get him back. But at a certain point, it's like, it's not even about that. You guys aren't even looking for him. That's the thing. Like, instead of just saying you made a mistake and getting back out there, you called the search off. My son's out there. That's not my son. They're like, well, he says it's your son. And you find out later, and this is, you know, a true story. So the kid admits later, like, yeah, I wanted to go to Los Angeles to meet Tom Mix. So I heard about the Collins boy in the paper. So I just said I was him. It's like, are you kidding me? Are you serious? So yeah, crazy.
I've got to watch that.
It's good. Yeah. So I'm probably,
you said it's a long movie. Is it like 2.5 hours, 3 hours long?
2.5 hours. Yeah. 2:22 maybe. But it's good. And it's a good film based on a true story. And, that was sort of before. So Clint Eastwood, I think lately is on like, I think some people said he's on like a mediocre streak, what was it he did? Like the Jersey Boys and all that stuff. but like, this is before, this is probably after Letters from Iwo Jima, I think, and Flags of Our Fathers. This is kind of, and before Gran Torino and before, you know, American Sniper and stuff like that. It's a good film. She was nominated for it. I don't think she won. But it's a very good performance from her. And again, great setting, you know, great cinematography. It's just kind of long, but I don't know what I would have changed about it. I don't know how you tighten up a movie like this.
I got to sit down and watch it.
It's good.
That sounds fantastic.
I'm probably still going to like give it away or, you know, but because you just don't watch it every 3 months, you know.
Yeah.
But it's definitely a film worth seeing and appreciating. Okay. Yeah, man, that's a great one. I don't think I've seen anything else.
I got two I want to talk about.
Ooh, okay. What you got?
I want to talk about James McAvoy and M. Night Shyamalan.
See, I want to see this.
You haven't seen this.
I have not seen this. Bro. I'm so excited.
Bro, let me tell you.
James McAvoy plays a character who has 23 personalities.
Yes.
In the film, I believe you meet 8 or 9 of them.
God. Hold on, sorry.
Wow. Is all I have to say. M. Night Shyamalan absolutely killed it with the movie Split.
This is what everyone is
I was blown away.
People were asking questions because he's sort of been blacklisted in a way, publicly blacklisted because of, you know, how
because
much...
of The Happening.
Yes.
Yeah. And The Village and Lady in the Water and all this other crap. And what was the one in the elevator? That was called Devil.
Devil. But that one, I think that was directed by him. I think that was
produced by him. Yeah.
From the mind. No, Michael, from the mind.
Oh,
of
my
M. Night
God.
Shyamalan.
From the mind of M. Night Shyamalan.
You know, so, in the movie Dragon of Hell, there's a demon called Alamia, and I thought they said a Shyamalamia.
At the end of the movie, I'm going to give it away. At the end of the movie, we have a cameo with a very talented bald man.
Oh, okay.
Named Bruce Willis.
Okay. I thought you were going to give away the plot. I was like, no.
After I saw that film, a couple weeks later, I think it may have been last week, where I saw an announcement from M. Night Shyamalan where he is going to bring Unbreakable and Split together to create a into his story for those two films.
See, I haven't seen Unbreakable either.
Dude, Bruce Willis, Samuel L. Jackson.
Yeah.
Dude.
No, somebody was talking about that recently. Dude. Yeah, I know. Someone was talking about that recently, and they said that, like, you know, Unbreakable, every time it gets brought up, I'm afraid, like, whenever I'm listening to them, like, oh, no, because I don't want them to spoil it. I don't know if there's much to spoil in Unbreakable, but yeah. I've heard that movie's good. I've been hearing that for, like, 15 years, and I still picked it up.
It is a slow film. Mm-hmm. It is I don't really give a shit about these characters until you're 70 minutes into the film.
Mm-hmm.
But wow, the ending is amazing. It's M. Night Shyamalan. I mean, you know, Split was better.
Okay.
Split was better.
Well, tell me about Split. What's the best part about Split, in your opinion?
James McAvoy and the range he has as an actor. I mean, he played 8 different characters with 8 different voices, 8 different body movements, 8 different personalities. I couldn't believe it, and I don't know anything about mental health. I don't know anything about schizophrenia. I don't know anything about multiple personality disorder. But from the representation in his vision,
the Shyamalamaverse,
it's pretty wild.
Yeah,
I mean it's. I wouldn't say it's relatable because I'm not insane, but
I am.
It was very, very worth my time, and I think it's worth your time. The music was incredible, the sound design was incredible, and there's a lot of design. There's a lot of aural design based around each character,
mm-hmm.
and the way M. Night Shyamalan uses color. You know how he is when he uses color. Each character has a color. I mean, it was just incredible. Did you see The Visit? I just saw that pop up.
The Visit?
The M. Night Shyamalan movie, The Visit, where the kids go to visit grandma and grandpa and You learn about grandma and grandpa.
I've seen, it's not often that, actually it's very often that trailers freak me out. I don't want to see that because I would like to sleep.
Oh my gosh. That movie was a beautiful train wreck is what that was. Oh, it had so much potential. It had so much potential. And then it just came collapsing down and you were like, really, really?
Oh my God.
So if you haven't seen Split, absolutely, absolutely check that out. That's dark.
Crazy.
And it was funny because, you know, I turned my living room into a 7.1 surround sound home theater. I mean, it's stupid. And I was watching this movie and I just got so worked up with it. I ended up pacing around the living room, standing and watching this movie and crossing my arms and pointing at the screen and going, no. And, you know, I just got way into it. It was a beautiful, beautiful story.
Dude, you've sold me.
Yeah, it was awesome. I have another one I want to talk about.
Okay.
La La Land.
Okay, tell me about La La Land.
Have you seen it?
I have not seen La La Land.
It was a major disappointment.
Oh.
It was beautiful. It was beautiful. It looked beautiful. It sounded beautiful. Everybody who acted in it had pretty faces and gorgeous clothes. And the backgrounds, the sets, they were gorgeous. The color correction. Mwah! Mm-hmm. It was filmmaking at its finest. But. And I got really jealous about how Ryan Gosling could play the piano. Because I got super jealous. Because the music was incredible. I kind of lusted after Ryan Gosling just a little bit, just because the way he played the piano. I mean, I'm a totally straight guy, and I was totally turned on by Ryan Gosling and the way he played the piano. It was absolutely beautiful. But Emma Stone, dude, I don't like her. I don't like Emma Stone.
Really?
Emma Stone looks like she smells like cat piss. Oh, God. She does. She looks like that. I don't know why she looks like that. I'm not saying she's not a talented actress. I'm saying she looks like she doesn't bathe, but that's neither here nor there. The ending of that film pissed me off so much. And I won't spoil it for you.
Right.
But you watch the whole movie and you think it's going one way, and then 10 minutes until credit rolls, they throw a $10 million flashback sequence in your face and they tie the movie up.
Huh.
Yeah. And when I say $10 million, it was probably $100 million. I'd like to know what the budget of this film was. I'm going to Google that.
You see, because like this movie, I always felt like this seemed like another one of those. And call me cynical, but whenever there's movies like this, I always wonder, like, is this just another Oscar grab where, you know, like The Artist, I watched it. Cool. You did a silent movie, but it wasn't that good.
Oh,
like it's cool. It's, I mean, being different isn't equivalent to being good. You can be good while not being different. You can be different and good, but different isn't automatically good. And just because it's been a while since we've done like an old Hollywood musical, that doesn't mean the first time we do it should be like ordained this, you know, this golden film. And even though I've heard mixed reactions, I've heard some people who really like this film. I've heard some people who were disappointed. And it's all in the eye of the beholder. I mean, like I've tried to be more decisive when it comes to trying to separate a good movie that I find problems with and a bad movie that maybe had moments, but that wasn't, maybe I enjoyed it, but maybe it wasn't enough objectively. You know, it's hard to, that's the hard part about film criticism that Dustin and I talk about this all the time. It's almost like, is it just me who didn't like it? Or do I think that other people don't like it? And I try to always boil it down to, well, what was it going for and did it achieve it? And it seemed, I don't know. Do you feel like it fell short of the bar it set for itself?
I think it was a film deliberately written to sell an idea and then to crush your soul with 10 minutes left. I think that's what he deliberately did. I don't know anything about the director. I don't know who wrote it.
I think the director wrote it too. Damien Chazelle is the director. I think he wrote it also.
I don't know who that is, but I did Google it and they spent $30 million to make it.
He did Whiplash, apparently. I saw that in the credits just here.
No way. I loved Whiplash.
Yeah.
The same guy did. Oh my gosh. I didn't know that.
I'll run it back and figure it out. I'm going to Google it. They said where are you? There it is. Let's see. Right there. From the writer and director of Whiplash.
Oh my goodness gracious. Damien Chazelle.
So how does a filmmaker make when I haven't seen Oh, Whiplash
he
did. Either.
He wrote 10 Cloverfield Lane and I loved that one too.
See, I've begun 10 Cloverfield Lane. That's the next one I'm going to watch.
Oh, it's awesome.
Yeah, I've heard good things about it, but so he wrote 10 Cloverfield Lane?
He sure did, according to IMDb, and he wrote Whiplash and he wrote La La Land.
So why do you think it was such a misstep then?
But he didn't direct 10 Cloverfield Lane.
No. That was
But he directed Whiplash and he directed La La Land. I don't know. I don't know what happened. I think he must be practicing the art of misdirection. I mean, clearly.
You think?
Yes. And I don't want to spoil it for you. I don't want to spoil it for anybody.
Mm-hmm.
But damn, I loved Ryan Gosling.
See,
he could really play the piano.
To me, he seemed like the least appealing feature of this film.
Yeah, I mean, wait until he plays the piano.
To me, the problem with Ryan Gosling, it's like, and this, again, this makes me sound cynical, but Ryan Gosling to me is most interesting because he's so funny. Like, obviously, he's a good looking guy, and so, but there's a tendency for guys like him, I'm not going to try and read into his motives, but I feel like sometimes guys like him, you know, sometimes can slum it, not even intentionally. I feel like he would play a lot of romantic leads, and maybe try to be in interesting ways, but not really breaking as much from genre as he would think he is. Right. And then you have a movie like this where it seems like that's exactly what he's doing. Is he's playing like a tortured artist kind of hero, but he's still a hunky, you know, scruffy looking dude. And you know, where you've got other. I mean, again, we're talking about all these great films I haven't seen, but you know, like The Nice Guys, I've heard he's great in The Nice Guys with Russell Crowe.
That's what I haven't seen.
Yeah. I can't really hear you. Are you really far back from your mic?
No, I'm sorry. That's one I haven't seen.
Yeah.
It's The Nice Guys, and I've seen it available on HBO. I just haven't picked it up.
Yeah. Yeah, man. I really want to see The Nice Guys, but Ryan Gosling seems like he's got a lot of comedic range, and I want to see more of that from him. I don't need to see him being, I don't know. I haven't seen the film, so I don't really know how it is.
Yeah.
Man, there's a lot of good movies I haven't seen. I'm trying to.
Well, I mean, you are a very busy man.
I'm
so busy. Don't put yourself down, buddy.
Yeah, dude. I'm trying.
You know what we watched on Netflix the other night and just laughed and laughed?
What?
Cool Runnings.
Oh my god, dude.
That's on Netflix.
You know, I got a couple more to talk about, but yeah, let's talk about Cool Runnings.
Oh, there's nothing to say other than if you haven't seen it, you're a loser. Like, go watch it.
If you haven't seen Cool Runnings, I don't think you like movies. Like, everyone's seen Cool Runnings.
It was so great. I couldn't believe it was on Netflix. We put it on and we laughed and laughed and laughed.
I love Cool Runnings. That's such a good movie.
Yeah.
Speaking of John Candy.
Yes.
So, my daughter won't stop watching Frozen, and I really can't stand it. I don't like the song. It's annoying, but it's also not a good movie. And I'm sort of tired of hearing it. And so lately I was like, hey, you know what? We're going to watch something else. So I went in to the movies. I was like, what do we got? You know, I got DVDs, and I got some DVDs that I bought, before I had kids and when I had money. And, and one of them was The Rescuers Down Under.
Yes, I saw your Facebook post about that.
Oh, dude, The Rescuer Down Under is. Can I see? There we go.
I haven't seen that in so long.
The Rescuers Down Under is such a good movie. And well, the trailer's in 4:3. That's adorable. so, yeah. I grew up loving The Rescuers Down Under. I saw The Rescuers Down Under before I even saw The Rescuers. I learned the plot of The Rescuers through a book, like an illustrated book. And that's how I found out it was a sequel. The Down Under was a sequel to something else. And man, The Rescuers Down Under, I think it was like 1992. I feel like it was 92. Everything about that movie is good. And I chalk it up a little bit to money. You know, I gotta resize this cause it's so little. yeah. So, The Rescuers Down Under takes place in Australia, Down Under, and, Bernard and Bianca, part of this rescue society of animals and mouses and stuff. This adventurous kid gets kidnapped by this poacher voiced by George C. Scott, who was incredible as this villain McLeach. And so these two mice are dispatched to go save him, and voiced by Bob Newhart and Ava Gabor.
Okay.
And it's just such a good movie. And part of it, it's so tight. And I think part of that is because, and I mentioned John Candy because he voices that albatross right there, Wilbur.
Oh, okay.
He's great. I love that shot, by the way, that horrible computer 3D buildings behind them. Here, I'll run that back for you so you can see it. He jumps off, they're taking off and it's all 2D. It's 2D. And they jump off this building and it's like this 2D, albatross, but it's these blocky 3D buildings.
That's awesome.
And if they show the opera house part, I'll show you that. It's great. I love this movie.
Connor, that's awesome that you say that. I actually have that on VHS sitting in my living room right now. I got to sit down and put it in and watch it in 4:3 ratio with,
oh my God,
with raw color and raw audio. That would be cool.
It's such a good film. And I think what I was saying before, I think the reason that it's so tight is because, money. I mean, back then it's like, everything better be essential to the story because we're spending a lot of money to animate this shit.
That's right.
So if this is unnecessary, it's not happening.
It's cut, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And so this film's like short. I feel that's like 80 or 90 minutes.
Really?
So many things I would just repeat on a loop as a kid came from this film. A lot of how I visualized action came from this film. There's an incredible sequence at the beginning where, Cody, the boy, rescues this giant golden eagle and he rides on him and he's just going through the clouds. He's just riding on his back. And it's the most like majestic sequence where, it starts with him getting accidentally knocked off of a cliff and the bird just flies down and saves him. And it's just, the music is tremendous. Like it's one of those few films that still had like a cue for like when the heroes would show up that, they'd do something and the kid's going over a waterfall and they're like, Bernard the boy. And it's like, he runs to get him and he's, it's going like na 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 na, and that's the Homeward Bound theme song. I remember that. I'll never forget that musical cue. But The Rescuers Down Under, it had like actual musical themes that would they would crescendo when things were happening, and yes, it added to the emotion. And that's, nowadays we're a little bit less into that. I think
I agree.
We're a lot more into we think it's gritty to not cue the emotion. And there's some truth to that. You don't want to tell people how to feel, when to feel, but when it's an action sequence, like something really cool is happening, you want to sort of, bring people on that ride. And I think the music in this film is terrific.
I need to sit down and give it a screening and, no, the way you're selling it right now is like, I think I'm going to pop it in tonight.
Oh my God, it's so good. And like even little things like their little mouse world, like how they send messages to each other. Like they'll send a coded message to some actual dude in a military base. And then the mice will be like, oh, that's our code. And so they'll call some phone that's away. The guy gets up and leaves and the mice run over to the keyboard. And then like four or five of them like type on the keyboard together, decipher your message and send it over to St. Louis. It was insane. you know.
Well, let me tell you this. I have a statement and I have a question.
Okay.
My statement is that you said Frozen was a terrible movie. Okay.
Yes.
That's neither here nor there. What is hysterical is that there is a snowman that said, "I love warm hugs." And that is hysterical. I don't care who you are.
Well, it's the thing. So that's one of those things. So so we're going to talk about Frozen now. Okay. So
No, we're not. We're not going to talk Frozen now. Well, all I'm saying is making a statement that the snowman said, "I love warm hugs," and I lost it. But my question for you was, what did the kids think about Rescuers? What did they think?
My kids liked it. They were actually looking. And I have a one-year-old son who doesn't even know what's going on.
Okay.
Fair. But my daughter was paying attention. And I thought that was interesting. There wasn't a bunch of loud, like, zip, 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 things happening. Yeah. You know, there were characters you cared about in danger, in peril, trying to save each other. I thought that, you know, and I, right off the bat, you know, I cheated a little bit because she'd be like, who dad? I'm like, nah, she didn't say it like that, like the New Orleans Saints, but she's like, who's dad? And I was like, that's Cody. She's like, oh, Cody. Okay. And I'm like, yeah, because I want you to know that kid's name, because when he falls off this cliff in a couple minutes, I want you to be scared that he's going to fucking die.
Yeah.
You know, I want you to care what happens to him when this mean poacher kidnaps him. Totally, by the way, totally crossing the line, you know, poaching. Okay. Like, poaching is against the law, but it's just aggressive hunting. You can, you know, like an argument can be made for whether or not poaching is bad. Maybe I'm, maybe not. Yeah, it's bad. But I think everyone agrees that kidnapping by the way, Cody's an idiot, because Cody's like, you're a poacher. This is a poacher's trap. And he's like, no. This is just a big hole that this salamander, it's like a 18-foot deep hole. He's like, this is a poacher's trap and you're a poacher. I'm going to report you to the Rangers. He's like, ah, Jesus. All right, we're taking you with us. It's like, that's awesome. Just be like, oh, yeah, I don't know anything, and run off like, yo, I'm going to call the cops, you know, like. You have to tell him right to his face, this dangerous man with a salamander who obeys him and a double barrel shotgun. You're going to tell him, like, hey, I'm going to report you. Fucking stupid idiot kid. Dumb kid. Anyway, it's a great movie. But can I say something about Frozen real quick?
Absolutely. Please.
So I fully acknowledge that Olaf, while being potentially the stupidest thing about the film, is actually one of the better things in that film, because he could have just been some dumb sidekick. Yeah. But he was voiced by a charismatic actor, Josh Gad.
Yeah.
He was, and everyone, you know, I'll give Frozen credit. Everyone who voiced it sang it. There was no stand-in singers. I'll give them credit for that. Josh Gad's a great singer. I thought it was really funny to have a snowman who has no idea how chemistry works and temperatures. I think it's very funny to have a snowman who fantasizes about going to the beach and completely has no idea that he will melt and die.
So great, dude.
Yeah. I think Olaf is one of the better things about Frozen. I can't argue with Olaf.
No. That's all I have to say about that.
And I'll say again, this is my opportunity to clear up this whole muddy issue. Frozen has a very good third act. Their third act, I thought, was very good, because the first two acts of that movie, I think, are not great.
Yeah,
I think they're formulaic. I think they're boring. I think they're kind of obnoxious. But I thought that their ending... I thought that their climax, by the way, was unique. It took unexpected twists and turns. The whole thing of, like, the true love's kiss, like, oh, she's going to go to Chris, you know, Kristoff now. It's like, no, I'm going to go to my sister. Like, oh, I didn't expect that. That's very, very, very cool of you guys to do that. Yeah. You know, the fact that it takes place on the frozen lake, the frozen fjord, I thought that was cinematically, I thought that was a cool way to end it, instead of just in the throne room or on the side of the castle on some broken balcony that was crumbling. I thought that was kind of cool. You know, but Frozen...
Well, I mean, it sounded great. It looked great. I agree about the first two acts. It did sound good and it did look good.
I'm just annoyed that it's not that it's really that terrible of a film. It's just that I think people are trying to make the argument that it's a terrific film, and it's a cultural phenomenon piggybacking on okay film, I thought. You know, that's what I thought. The other great movie that I saw with these Disney, with these golden edition animated classics.
Yeah.
And again, I liked these already because these are movies I own. The Great Mouse Detective. Have you ever seen that?
That's one I saw when I was a kid. That's one I haven't seen in years. That actually might be one that I have on VHS in this random box I have out there.
Dude, The Great Mouse Detective, 1986. I didn't even realize that. That's crazy. Jeez,
that's before we were born.
86. So 1986. So the great thing about The Great Mouse Detective too is that so that was one of the first films to blend CG, to blend computer animation with 2D.
Really?
You know when Basil, let me see if I can find the clip of it, but there's a part in the movie. Let me see. Hold on. Let me see. Stop it. I don't want you to play right now, you stupid idiot. There's a part in the movie where Basil gets knocked out and he wakes up in a clock tower. He wakes up inside Big Ben. Oh, here it is. I got the whole chase for you right here. And that was the first time it had ever been used. I'll get it right here for you. Sorry about that, people. I'm trying to do some magic here. You don't understand how crazy it is. I can just pull these up in a moment's notice. Where is it? I'm sorry, Michael.
You good?
What's it called? The Great Mouse Detective. Big Ben Chase. Yeah, I gotta refresh it. He wakes up inside Big Ben, and there's gears going on around him the whole time. Where is it? I'm getting pissed off. I can't find it.
Don't get pissed off.
No. Well, anyway, it's really cool. Let me just play something else while we're looking for that. Oh, there it is right there. I had to refresh it. Stupid thing. All right, there we go. Yeah, so he wakes up inside of Big Ben. And so he's, let me make it a little bit smaller for you. So you see all those gears? Like that is, yeah. That is, those are computer animated, and Basil's still 2D. And I think that is just incredible. You know, for 1986, for that to be like the first time that's done, and it's done so well, I mean, that's a milestone in animation. And not to mention that this film is really, you know, it's really based on Sherlock Holmes and Moriarty. Incredibly adult, by the way. They're singing a song for Professor Radigan at some point, and they talk about how this scheme he's concocting is worse than the widows and orphans he drowned.
Oh my gosh.
What? Because I'm watching it with the subtitles because my kids are making noises, and I'm like, all right, I can't hear.
Yeah, I'll read it.
And I read it. I was like, yo, yeah. Not okay.
That's too funny, man.
Yeah.
But I gotta sit down and watch both of those, man. It's like a blast from the past.
Oh my God. Great Mouse Detective is fantastic. And again, a tight animated film. Just fantastic. Great, great movies.
Nice.
Well, Michael, I think we've reached the end of our rope tonight. Fantastic. I walk away with like five movies I have to now watch because of you.
Oh my gosh, dude.
You just add more to my plate.
I'm sorry. I'm a terrible friend.
No, it's a good thing. I just have a lot of other stuff to watch, but I'm going to get to all of it. Damn it. I'm getting
you will.
I will.
You will. Yeah.
Yeah.
Don't forget to sleep though.
Yeah, I'll sleep. I'll sleep. I slept this morning. My son had had a fever like all weekend.
Uh-oh.
And he was at like 104.5 this morning. Yeah. So I called in to every place I work at and, you know,
had to take the day. Sorry.
Yeah, it was pretty bad, and you know, you got to give him the medicine, and he doesn't want to eat the medicine, and there's other medicines you give kids? Would you? I've administered 4 suppositories in the past couple of days. Oh, yes.
You're a good father.
First and hopefully last time I'll do
anything. He will never know. He will never know how lucky he is.
He will never know. I'm not going to tell him. I'm not going to tell him. I think it'll freak him out.
Wait until he's like 18 or something.
Yeah, I'll just tell him in front of his friends, like, man, yeah. My finger up your butt once.
When you say it like that, it's... What? Yeah. Dad.
Like, yeah. It's funny. Yeah. His birthday is tomorrow, actually. His birthday is tomorrow. Oh, great. He'll be a year old.
That's awesome, dude.
1 year
That's old. That's awesome. That's exciting.
It is exciting. It is
what
exciting.
What do you do for a 1-year-old birthday?
You make little monster faces out of plates and construction paper. I say you. I mean, my wife.
Oh, yes. No, no. And why would you?
I mean... my wife did that, and it looks really good. And
that's fun.
Yeah, we're gonna have people over and stuff. It's pretty cool. You know, it's interesting. Here's an interesting thing. I'll tack this on since we're on the subject of my kids, but I'll try to bring it back to movies. So I thought about this recently. Not recently. I thought about this as soon as he was born. I said, you know, what's great is I really want to share movies with them.
Yeah.
But I don't want to like pass my cynicism on to them. But I just want to be able to take them to the movies. And so I figured, so what's great about her birthday's in January, early January. And I said, okay, so January's not a great month for movies, but what is still in theaters in January is all the Oscar-y stuff. Yes. All the period pieces, you know, the higher concept, emotional sort of dramas, which I thought was pretty well suited to the female audience, typically into more intellectual subjects when there's a lot more going on with characters. You know, you don't see a lot of women who really want to go see Die Hard. They want to see like the young Victoria and stuff, and not because they're girls in those dresses. It's just because there's more going on between certain kinds of characters and a certain kind of story. A drama lends itself more to people who want less spectacle and more actual internal stuff. And so what's cool about him is he's got his birthday is May 2nd. So what's always going to be in the theaters, this is going to come off incredibly sexist, I guess, but what's great is that in theaters in early May are blockbusters, action movies. There are big things happening. Men, and you know this, men are much more visually wired. You know, we're all about visuals. We want explosions. We want some action. You know, character stuff is great, but that's really secondary to spectacle. We want spectacle when we go to the movies.
That's a really great way to put it. And you're exactly right.
And I thought, and women, you know, not that women can't appreciate spectacle, but women want to be invested in the story. Women want to know who these characters are more than men, you know, excluding film critics and people in the industry, like just the general audience. Men are paying $12. They want some explosions. They want some gunfights. They want some ladies cars, in bathing suits, cars, you know. Want
the guns, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, exactly. And women are like, you know, I'll go, but I want to be interested. I don't care about that stuff. Visuals don't excite the female audience at large, unless it's 50 Shades of Grey. But I thought that's really interesting that my kids, you know, my daughter and my son, their birthdays are on those ends of the year where my son's, you know, same as me. My birthday is May 5th. My son and I have the same birthday week. So thank you. Friday. So when I turned 13, my brother took me to go see Spider-Man, Sam Raimi's Spider-Man.
Okay.
And I just remember thinking like starting there, it was like, there's always gonna be something in theaters for me on my birthday.
Always.
This year, I'm going to go see Guardians of the Galaxy.
Like, does that come out this week?
Yeah, it's Friday.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, and so I'm going to go see that because there's always something good on my birthday that excites me.
Yeah.
You know?
Let me know how that is. I want to talk to you next Monday, and you got to tell me how that is.
I will. I think I'm pretty excited. I'm trying to stay away from people talking about it. But
James Gunn is a badass, but what impresses me most about James Gunn is his use of soundtrack in his film.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the music licensing nightmares he must have are just incredible.
Pretty sure Marvel takes care of that for him.
Well, regardless, man, it's pretty great. I'm excited to see that. I love the first Guardians. I didn't realize that the second one was ready.
Dude, I didn't even go to theaters for the first Guardians, and I found that I discovered it after the fact. And that's one of the ones that when I first saw it, I was like, it wasn't that great. And every time I see it, it gets so much better.
Yeah.
And I really appreciate it.
And you got to love Chris Pratt.
I'm a little bit less in Marvel's pocket now.
like I've said several times on the show, I'm not into the superhero films. I'm not. I never have been. I'm not into it. But James Gunn is a good storyteller.
Yeah, he is.
You know, he's a good storyteller. And I like his use of practical effects. It's not all – I mean, a lot of it is CGI, but not all of it is CGI. And the dance battle at the end of Guardians 1, I mean, come on. Yeah. I mean, it's fantastic.
Yeah, it was. It was fun.
So
I really appreciate Guardians now, and I'm excited for 2.
Yeah.
And I just thought it was kind of cool, and, you know, every time I do, like, I make broad generalizations about the sexes, my wife, you know, tells me not to, but I think that one's interesting. I think that because I may not know a lot of what I'm talking about in that area, but I know movie-going audiences, and I know box office trends, and you're going to get a bunch of dudes to go out and see, like, the Expendables. And the female audience, and it's when you put two different kinds of films who open on the same weekend, something, counter marketing, is that what it is?
I'll go with it.
God, I forgot what it's called. I think it's counter marketing. That's what happened when they, remember when they put Winnie the Pooh out the same weekend as the Deathly Hallows? Disney thought that they were that they were counter marketing Warner Brothers, and it was like, no, we want to see Winnie the Pooh also, but we want to see Harry Potter more. Like, you typically, you know, when you've got one kind of film, you know, you don't want to put it the same weekend as the type of film that's just like it, because then you got to fight for it.
Exactly.
You know? So you pick, like, what's our audience? Okay, so will that audience be coming out to see Harry Potter? They won't. Okay, so I just think that's kind of cool. So the big takeaway from that is, I thought, I can take my kids to the movies every year for their birthday when they're old enough, because I think there will always be something in there that they're interested in seeing.
Absolutely. And gender roles and marketing.
Exactly. And I really look forward to that. And again, like, I don't know if it is bad for me to think of it like that? Because, like, I really do think that's true. My daughter is, you know, movies like Frozen do come out, and did Frozen come out in December? Because now I'm going to look like a jackass if it came out
in March. I don't know. Let's see.
But you know what I mean? Like, as a guy, like, you're probably going to the movies more during
the
summer.
Came out Thanksgiving 2013.
Thanksgiving. Okay. So it's hanging around in theaters in early January. Right. So I thought about that, you know, about a year ago when my son
was coming. It's insightful.
Yeah. I just thought it was kind of cool. So, a little tidbit about kids and stuff. Anyway, okay. Well,
happy birthday to you, and happy birthday to your son. And I'm excited to hear your review of Guardians 2. Oh, that rhymed. I should be a rapper.
All right. Well, everybody, Michael, thanks for doing the show with me this week.
Thank you for having me, buddy. It's always a pleasure.
Always happy to have you. And, man, this stupid thing is, gotta turn all these off. I hate it. Anyway, all right. Well, anyway, guys, thanks for listening and watching. And tune in next week. We'll have me and someone doing the show talking about something. Probably Guardians. So I need to get Dustin back, because I wonder if he'll see it over the weekend. But I certainly will be seeing it this weekend. So, yeah. All right. Thanks, guys. I'm going to roll this outro and see if it works. Oh, look at that.
All right.